loose items in the pouch in front of you.
Have a safe and informative journey.
Hello, I'm Nathan Hartman, and this is Dreamfinders, a podcast about the creative culture of Disney theme parks. For many, getting to know the life of Walt Disney might include several places. Marceline, his childhood town, Disneyland, his dream theme park, or maybe even the Walt Disney Family Museum in San Francisco. But there's another spot, one where the origins of not only a cartoon mouse, but possibly the entirety of Hollywood animation stems, the Laugh-O-Gram Studio in Kansas City. This is where Walt first cut his teeth, combining animation and live-action elements, but today, the poor studio is just a husk of a building, known only by those devotees who seek it out. Dan Viets wants to change all that. He's the president of Thank You Walt Disney, a nonprofit organization dedicated to the preservation and restoration of Walt Disney's Laugh-O-Gram Studio, and he was kind enough to sit with me and chat about how Walt's creativity blossomed in Kansas City, how a local amusement park most likely inspired Disneyland, and how Dan's journey connects with Kansas City now having two, yes, two, Tomorrowland Moonliners. All of that and more is coming right up on Dreamfinders. Dan Viets, thank you so much for coming on Dreamfinders.
You're very welcome. My pleasure.
So before we get into the wonderful stuff your organization, Thank You Walt Disney, is up to in Kansas City, I'm curious about your passion and connection with animation. Were you an avid cartoon viewer at a young age? What brought you into loving what Disney was all about?
Well, my earliest recollections of Disney are probably seeing Snow White in about 1957. I assumed it was a new movie. Of course, it was 20 years old and in re-release, but that made a big impact on me. And of course, the Mickey Mouse Club, especially Annette Funicello, were a big interest when I was a young kid. And of course, since then, I developed an interest in film history generally and Missouri history, where I grew up and live. And those two topics intersect, of course, with the life of Walt Disney.
And that's a good point. Did you grow up in the Columbia area, or where did you grow up in Missouri?
I grew up in the northwest corner of Missouri on a small farm, kind of like Walt in Marceline. And so that was a childhood, I think, somewhat similar to what Walt experienced. Although Walt, when he was at Marceline, had the good fortune to be so close to town that he could, even as a very young boy, he could walk into town. And he could be part of that small town as well as the farm on the edge of town.
Growing up, did you have that understanding that Walt was a fellow Missourian? Was that an impact on you at a young age? I'm sure you had heard of Marceline.
Well, actually, I don't know that I had heard of Marceline when I was a young child. Marceline's a small town. It's a little bit out of the way. It's not really on a major thoroughfare in Missouri. Of course, I was aware of Walt Disney, and when I learned that he had lived in Missouri for a good part of his life, that's when I became really intrigued with learning more about Walt's life. And I know now, and most Disney fans know, that he lived for more than 5 years in Marceline, and Marceline had a big impact on him. But he also lived for more than 10 years in Kansas City, Missouri.
What were your memories of Walt when he was alive? Because clearly you were at an age where his television show was around, Disneyland was just coming off the ground. What sort of impact culturally do you think that had on you?
Walt programmed me and millions of other kids to want to go to Disneyland. I mean, I can recall seeing Walt on the Sunday night program. Of course, it began on Wednesdays on ABC, but the segments I recall were on NBC, the Wonderful World of Color segments. And when Walt would sit on that desk and talk about building Disneyland, talk about new attractions at Disneyland, it was just very intriguing. And it was very effective. You know, in a way, those programs were commercials for Disneyland. Of course, the original name of what became the Wonderful World of Color was actually Disneyland, the name of the television show when it was on ABC. Was Disneyland, and each of the segments in the early days was supposed to relate to a specific land within the park. So, of course, the Davy Crockett episodes related to the western segments, Frontierland, and the segments that were about space travel related to Tomorrowland. And many of the episodes, of course, the classic animated films related to Fantasyland, and so forth. So there was a very conscious connection between Disneyland and the television program. And it became, it was a very ingenious way of promoting the theme park and promoting its films. You know, it was commercially successful, but it was a commercial, really, for the movies and for the theme parks.
Well, of course, it was impactful. So let me ask you the question, were you able to convince your parents to take you to Disneyland during that time?
Well, no, that never seemed like a possibility. I don't think it ever occurred to me to suggest such a thing. You know, we never traveled to California when I was a little kid. But when I grew up, insofar as I have grown up, when I got bigger and made my first trip to California, I went directly and immediately to Disneyland. The first time I drove across the country, I knew exactly where I was headed, and we went straight to Disneyland as soon as we got to Los Angeles. And I've, of course, been back many, many times since then. Never tire of visiting that park, or for that matter, the Florida parks as well. They're all great fun.
You know, you seem to have kept this affection strong for Disney and his creations and sort of the history of that. Was that intentional, or did you fall into it, back into it later in your life, or how did that occur? Was your passion consistent?
Well, there was a period of time when I didn't have a conscious obsession with Disney, and it really blossomed around 25 years ago. Again, when I began to realize how much of an impact his years growing up in Missouri had on Walt's life and on his work, then I became truly obsessed with that and read everything I could find and started doing original research. And that's one of the great things about living here in Missouri, is that you can actually dig up facts that no one else has found yet about Walt Disney or about the experiences he had as a young child, both in Marceline and in Kansas City, Missouri. So that's one thing that keeps me interested. When I had the opportunity to work on the book, Walt Disney's Missouri, The Roots of a Creative Genius, that was published by the Kansas City Star back in, I think, 2002 was the original publication year. You know, that was great fun. That really forced me to focus and do some further research. And I'm proud of that book. It's a small coffee table type book. It's really easy to read. Got color on almost every page. The NC Star did a nice job of laying that book out and putting it into a very inviting form. It's got some photographs of young Walt in Kansas City that were never published anywhere else. It's got some images and some information about the theme park that Walt almost built in St. Louis, Missouri. That's a little known fact. Before he built Walt Disney World, Walt was involved in very serious discussions with the civic leaders in St. Louis about building a theme park right there on the banks of the Mississippi River. He also was very seriously considering building a much smaller theme park back in Marceline. It would have been a park that reflected his rural roots and would have helped to show kids what it was like when he was growing up. And when he died and when his brother Roy died, then, you know, the interest in pursuing that project also died with them. The St. Louis project could very well have become a reality, but the civic leaders in St. Louis, I think very foolishly, declined to finance. I mean, we would have a major theme park in the center of downtown St. Louis today if the civic leaders in St. Louis had been willing to pass a bond issue. And that bond issue would have been paid off long ago, and the park would be generating revenue for St. Louis, but that didn't happen, and that's really a shame. Of course, a lot of the ideas that Walt had for the St. Louis theme park became reality in California, Florida. For instance, there are plans for the Pirates of the Caribbean in the plans, the blueprints that were drawn up for the St. Louis theme park. And the Haunted Mansion, another project. Now, I'm not saying that the original idea for those projects came up in St. Louis, but Walt developed those plans much more specifically, much more thoroughly, while he was planning the St. Louis Park. And so it's amazing. And we have actually reproduced some of the blueprints for those projects in our book. So, you know, working on that book was tremendous fun. I'm really proud of the fact that we were able to verify something Walt had said. You know, the closest we have to an autobiography of Walt Disney is the book that is attributed to his daughter Diane and Pete Miller, who worked with the Saturday Evening Post at that time. And it's called The Story of Walt Disney. And it's based all, it's almost entirely audio recordings that were made, that were interviews that, that Pete Miller and Diane Disney Miller, no relation, did in preparation for that book. So The Story of Walt Disney is pretty much the exact words of Walt Disney. But one of the things he talks about in that book is the fact when he was a young boy and was delivering newspapers in Kansas City, working for his father, Elias, that he had to go out and throw those papers every morning, no matter what the weather was like. And Elias didn't even own a car. There was no question of being driven around. When the weather was bad, he had to go out and throw those papers. It could be storming. It could be a blizzard. And he said that he recalled having to trudge through snowdrifts that were taller than he was to deliver newspapers in Kansas City. Well, Diane and I think others who heard those stories thought, well, maybe that's an exaggeration. Maybe it wasn't really as bad as her dad said it was. But, you know, we went back and checked the records of the United States Weather Bureau, and it turns out that that first winter that Walt Disney spent in Kansas City, the winter of 1911 to 1912, to this day, is still the record holder for the greatest amount of snowfall in a single winter, and the greatest amount of snowfall in a single month, and the greatest amount of snowfall in a single day. All of those records for snowfall to this day are still the snowfall of that winter. So Walt was not exaggerating. No, he was just a little 9-year-old boy, and you can be sure that the snow drifts, the snowfall might not have been taller than it was, but the snow drifts were certainly taller than it was. And so I just got a chill when I realized that, that we could verify something Walt said that a lot of people thought was exaggeration. And it was not an exaggeration. It was the absolute truth. I also tend to think that Walt was telling the truth when he told the story many, many times. He told the story that it was in our building. It was in the building where Lapogram Films operated, that he tamed and kept as a pet a mouse that he met while he was working there. Now, Walt not only worked at the Lapogram building, he lived in the Lapogram building. He didn't have an apartment. It was his home and his workplace. So he slept, he said, on a pile of canvas for a bed. And he said that at night, as he slept, the mice would come out to play and eat. And that the leftovers from his employees' lunches in a wire wastebasket were an attraction for those mice. And he would lay there and watch these mice go into that wire wastebasket and take out their food. So he said that they then began to leave food out for them. He would put cheese and other morsels of food out and see how close he could get those mice to come to him. And he said that one little mouse was braver than the others, and he took that mouse, and that mouse became his pet. And at various times lived in a drawer of his desk, or at sometimes lived in a small cage that he kept in his animation studio, but that the mouse would come out and literally play on his drawing board while Walt worked at making animated films there in Kansas City. And then he said that when he gave up on Kansas City, his business went bankrupt, and he knew he had to move on to Los Angeles, that he made a point of taking that mouse out to a place in the country where he hoped he would be safe, because there were cats downstairs in that same building, and he did not want his pet mouse to fall victim to the cats there at the Lapogram building. So it's a great story. Some people think that's just made up, but I don't think it's made up. I think that he probably did exactly that. And I'm not saying that Walt never exaggerated. I think everybody, you know, no one's memory is perfect. But I don't think that he just made something like that up out of whole cloth. I think that was probably very true. I think there's no doubt that the concept and the idea of that mouse character did come from the mouse he kept as a pet in a studio in Kansas City, Missouri.
Let's talk about that Lapogram studio a little bit. One thing that you have said on the website for Thank You, Walt Disney, is that the entire Hollywood animation industry can be traced back to Lapogram. So why is that? Explain that.
Yes, I'm happy to, because because I think, again, this is something that's not widely recognized, although this information is all in the public record. But it's not, no one's really pulled it together and realized how, I think, how profound it really is. But we know, for instance, that among the young Kansas City animators who worked with Walt at his Laugh-O-Gram studio were Hugh Harmon and Rudy Ising. And they were just, I mean, they just learned their craft there along with Walt. They were all very young men at that time. And when Walt got a foothold in Hollywood, Roy, of course, was already out there. And the first animator from Kansas City that Walt convinced to come out and join him was of iWorks. But not long after that, as the studio, making at that point the Alice Comedies, as it became more successful and as the workload increased, there were no animators in Hollywood at that point. Walt Disney was the first Hollywood animator. All the animation being done up to that point was being produced in New York and New Jersey, but he was the first Hollywood animator. So he convinces of iWorks to join him, and by many experts' opinion, of iWorks was perhaps the greatest animator, certainly of his time, maybe of all time. But he then lured to join him, since there were no animators in Hollywood to draw on, he lured his other friends from Kansas City to Hollywood, and among them were Hugh Harmon and Rudy Ising. Now, Harmon and Ising were partners as animators for the rest of their lives, and when they left Disney after working with the Walt Disney Studio in Hollywood for a couple of years, when they left there, they became the founding animators at Warner Brothers. Now, you know, next to Disney, Warner Brothers was the most productive and influential studio in Hollywood. And Harmon and Ising were the founders. They didn't stay there terribly long. They then went on to become the founding animators at MGM, which, again, one of the major animation studios in Hollywood history. And while they were working in these places, they taught a couple of younger animators who were named Bill Hanna and Joe Barbera how to animate. And, of course, Friz Freleng, whose real name was Isidore Freleng, was one of the other animators that had known Walt in Kansas City. Technically, I don't think that Friz Freleng worked for Walt, but he worked at the studio where Walt learned to animate, and that was the A.B. Cogger Kansas City Film Ad Studio. But Walt knew Friz Freleng from Kansas City. Friz was a little bit younger than Walt and the other boys, but he also lured Friz Freleng out to Hollywood to work for him. And, of course, Friz later on became one of the most influential animators at Warner Brothers. The character of Yosemite Sam is based on Friz Freleng. Friz Freleng had a notoriously short temper. He was kind of a short guy, and so Yosemite Sam is Friz Freleng. You know, and of course, Friz Freleng not only worked for decades at Warner Brothers, but then left Warner's and became one of the founders of the DePatie Freleng Studio. DePatie Freleng, best known for the Pink Panther. Another example of this Kansas City influence is a man named Bugs Hardaway, Joseph, but nicknamed Bugs Hardaway, had worked in Kansas City, again, not for Walt, but he nonetheless was a Kansas City artist who moved out to Hollywood and worked at Warner's for many years. Well, one of the assignments that Bugs Hardaway had was to draw a rabbit character for a cartoon, and that rabbit was referred to, he didn't really have a name, but he was referred to as Bugs's with the apostrophe S, you know, in the possessive sense, Bugs's bunny. And so Bugs's bunny became Bugs Bunny, of course. So I believe it's no exaggeration to say that you trace the roots of the entire Hollywood animation industry to Walt Disney's Laugh-O-Gram studio.
I think the interesting thing about Laugh-O-Gram is some of the work that they were doing in Kansas City. Alice's Wonderland was a series that they did in Kansas City, and it's very unique for what it is. And how does it really show Walt's innovation at a young age?
You're correct that the pilot episode of the Alice Comedies was made at Laugh-O-Gram in Kansas City, and that was perhaps the most ambitious of the entire series. And it definitely was very innovative. Now, in a sense, it drew on what the Fleischer brothers back in the Northeast, New York and New Jersey, were doing. And they had a series called Coco the Clown. And Coco the Clown would pop out of an inkwell in live action. you'd see an animator studio, an artist studio, and this clown character in animated form would pop out of an inkwell or an ink bottle, and Coco would interact with the live action environment and the live action characters that appeared in those films. Well, Walt had an idea to reverse that, to place a live action little girl in a cartoon environment, and to have this live action little girl interact with animated characters. And so the concept for the Alice comedies was born. And Walt knew exactly who he wanted to portray little Alice, and that was a girl he had met at the Kansas City Film Ad Company, whose name was Virginia Davis. Little Virginia was a really cute and very precocious little girl, and her mother clearly was a stage mother, although Virginia didn't think so. But there's just no other explanation. No little four-year-old girl manages to get herself into show business without her mother's encouragement. So she had appeared in some ads at the Kansas City Film Ad Company for a bread company, one in particular. So little Virginia became the Alice on the Alice comedies in that first episode. And that first episode is so remarkable because Walt Disney also appears, and so do the other animators at the Laugh-O-Gram Studio. They appear in live action in that first Alice comedy. The Alice comedies were what really gave Walt his start in Hollywood. That was his first series of cartoons or cartoon live action combination. Walt had also done live action film, by the way, in Kansas City. His work in Kansas City was not limited to animation, although clearly the animation was very important to him. But he also produced a lot of live action short films in Kansas City. And of course, that was true throughout his career. He was not, well, in the early years of Hollywood, he was doing primarily animation, of course, but he went back to live action film not too long after that. And live action films, I think a lot of folks who don't really know Disney's history and work think only of his animated work. But his live action films, of course, were very, very impressive. And he was doing live action in Kansas City, just as he was doing animation in Kansas City. But the Alice comedies, that first episode was a great sales tool. And Walt sent that first episode to the foremost distributor of animated films in America at that time, a woman named Margaret Winkler. He was distributing Crazy Cat and Felix the Cat, and Walt went to her and sold her on the concept of the Alice comedies. So he got a letter back. He had begun his correspondence with Margaret Winkler when he was still in Kansas City. You know, we have these letters. Thank goodness we still have these letters, so we know exactly what was said between them. And he wrote to Mrs. Winkler when he arrived in Hollywood and said, he said something like, I have an exciting new concept here, and these Alice comedies are going to be a great hit. And we've moved out of Kansas City. We're now in Hollywood, and we're making movies. Well, he wasn't really yet, but he hoped to, you know, make movies in Hollywood. And he sold her on the concept. She wrote back and said, I will give you a contract to make those Alice comedies, but you've got to get that same little girl that appeared in the first one. Well, I don't think she realized that little girl lived in Kansas City. But Walt was undeterred. He wrote to Mr. and Mrs. Davis in Kansas City and said, you know, there's a great opportunity for little Alice out here in Hollywood. If you guys will just move to Los Angeles, Virginia will star as Alice in a whole series. I've got a new contract. Well, you know, the thing is that when she was not making an Alice comedy, there was really no work for little Alice. And Walt had made her sign a contract that was an exclusive. She couldn't work for other studios. And so after making about 14 episodes of the Alice comedies, little Alice, or her mother, actually decided that, you know, she wanted her daughter to have more work. And so, indeed, she did find more work. And Virginia had a pretty impressive career. Now, she never became a big name, but she appeared with some big names. For instance, she appears in the MGM musical The Harvey Girls, which is a beautiful Technicolor extravaganza. The song, The Atchison, Topeka, and the Santa Fe was the Oscar winner for best song that year. And I believe that was 1944, if I recall correctly. And she sung and danced as an adult right next to Judy Garland in that film, although she's not credited in that film. But I I remember I spent a fun afternoon with Virginia, and we still framed that film, and she'd say, "There I am in this scene, there I am in that scene," and she was. she was a very talented performer. Now, like a lot of women actors, when her husband came back from World War II, he'd been a fighter pilot in the war, and thank goodness he did come back. You know, she chose to stop working in the movies, but she had a great career as an interior decorator, as a magazine editor. She was a very bright lady, and you can see that even when she's a little girl. You can see how smart she is in those Dallas comedies. I really treasure the time I got to spend with Virginia Davis. She was a lot of fun. You know, I was so lucky to be, and it was because of Virginia, I was so lucky to be present at the 75th anniversary of the Walt Disney Company. Now, the Legend Awards, every Disney fan knows about the Legend Awards. Well, Virginia got her Legend Award on October 16, 1995. And to the day, that was the 75th anniversary of the day that Walt signed his contract with Margaret Winkler to make the Alice comedies. So Dave Smith, of course, the original founding archivist of the Disney Company, declared that this is the founding date of the Walt Disney Company. And you could say the company started when Walt started Laugh-O-Gram in Kansas City. But as far as the Hollywood Disney Company, I think that's a very appropriate date to choose. So on the 75th anniversary of that date, they had the biggest Legends Award that I think has ever taken place. Because I knew Virginia, I got to weasel my way in there. You know, it was an event that had a very limited audience, probably not more than 200 people, I would guess, were present. And it was held on the Legends Courtyard, which is the area directly in front of the Seven Dwarfs building that Michael Eisner built on the Burbank Studios while he was CEO. And in that little courtyard, you know, they set up chairs, but I would guess there were no more than a couple hundred chairs there. And I almost felt guilty about being there, but I'm thinking, gosh, how many people have worked for the Walt Disney Company for decades and they're not attending this event? But every winner of the Legend Award was present that day. Every living recipient of the Legend Award was present that day. And so I got to meet Bess Parker, got to meet, of course, the Sherman brothers, Dick Van Dyke, Haley Mills, her dad, John Mills, who was the father in Swiss Family Robinson, one of the greatest live-action Disney films. Oh, Kurt Russell, Glynis Johns from Mary Poppins. I mean, it just goes on and on and on. I was in heaven. And then the ultimate thrill, you know, that day was getting to meet Annette Funicello. And, you know, she was very ill, and no one knew whether she really would be able to make it, but she had a good day. She was feeling good, and right there in the Disney archives, I got to meet Annette Funicello. I mean, that was a boyhood dream come true, I'll tell you. And that was all because I knew Virginia. Now I'm out there in L.A. for some other event. It might have been a Disneyland convention or something, but I was in touch with Virginia. I knew she was getting her award. And I said to her on the phone, I said, "Well, Virginia, do you need a date for this event?" She says, "Yeah, I do need a date for this event." She says, "Call up this guy. I can't remember his last name. It seems like it was Jeff somebody. It might have been Jeff Curdy, but I'm not sure about that." So I call this guy up, and I say, "Hey, I'm a friend of Virginia's, and she'd like me to be her escort for the Legend Awards." He says, "You're in." He says, "Just show up. We'll have a valet take your car. You'll have a reserved seat there, and you'll be very welcome." And, oh, man, it just doesn't get any better.
So what I think is very interesting is sort of the contrast here. You have in California one might even say religious esteem for the company and giving out awards and honoring the history. But the old Laugh-O-Gram wasn't exactly seeing the best days in Kansas City, I would say, is a fair assessment.
It was tough.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was very tough.
Where did you come in your desire to save this old kind of husk of a building and make it what it once was?
I was doing research at the Kansas City Public Library, the central facility of the Kansas City Public Library. And as many people may know, and I believe it's in the Walt Disney Story, Walt talks about learning to animate by checking out two books from the Kansas City Public Library. And while I was there, I saw correspondence that Walt had with the manager of the Kansas City Public Library, and they had corresponded back, I think, in the 1940s. And the head of the library wrote to Walt Disney and said, "Do you have any recollection of visiting the Kansas City Public Library when you lived here? And did the library have any impact on your career?" Well, Walt wrote a letter back, and clearly it was written by him, not by some studio staff person. He wrote back to the head of the library and said, "I certainly did. I visited the library many, many times during my 10 years living in Kansas City." He says, "When I worked for the Kansas City Film Ad Company, they were making stop-motion animation, and that was Walt's first experience, of course, with professional animation. But he knew that the cartoons he saw at the local theaters were not made with paper cutouts. They were not made with stop-motion. They were made with drawings. And Walt was an artist. His ambition up to that point had been to draw cartoons for magazines like Saturday Evening Post and Life, and Judge was a big magazine title back then. But he changed his ambition when he went to work for the Kansas City Slide Company. He saw that it would be possible to make his drawings move. And so he taught himself to animate drawings by checking out, and Ub Iwerks with him, the two of them, went to the Kansas City Public Library and checked out two books. And one of them was Edward Muybridge's classic work on high-speed photography of animals in motion and the human figure in motion. What better source if you want to animate mice and ducks and dogs is to see this high-speed study of how animals really do move. He also checked out a book called by Carl Lutz, and I think it's simply Animation, maybe the title. And it's a very nuts and bolts kind of work that was very pragmatic, very practical, very useful. And it showed how you could just build an animation table and how to set up your camera to record sequential drawings. And so with those two books, Walt and Ub taught themselves how to animate. So the work that he did in Kansas City was so fundamental to his entire career, both live action and animated filmmaking, the idea of combining live-action characters with an animated background, which we see, of course, in Mary Poppins, one of Walt's last and greatest films. So many of the things he did throughout his life can be traced to Kansas City. And although he didn't build any theme parks in Kansas City, he certainly visited theme parks there. And by far, the most impressive theme park that Walt would probably ever have seen until he moved to Los Angeles was Electric Park in Kansas City. And in our book, we publish a few of the postcards that exist. And thank goodness there are quite a few postcards that exist of Electric Park in Kansas City. It was a spectacular place. It called itself the Coney Island of Kansas City, and that was not an exaggeration. It was a beautiful park. It was well-maintained. It was clean. It was very nicely landscaped, had flower beds. It was not like a carnival. It was not like a kind of a trashy and not so appealing carnival. It was a beautiful permanent theme park, and it contained, along with the rides, of course, they had trains, they had roller coasters, they had a log flume ride, but they also had some very nice performing areas. And much like Disneyland and the Disney World parks, they had areas for professional performers. And one of the great things about Electric Park is that during the summer of 1915, that John Philip Sousa and his band, the nation's greatest marching band ever, played for the whole summer in Electric Park. So you know this is a major attraction. This park was a major thing. And it had hundreds of thousands of electric lights at a time when most people's homes did not have electricity. So the nighttime attraction of seeing all of the buildings and all of the architecture outlined in white lights at Electric Park, I think probably led to doing the same thing in Disneyland. You know, anybody who's been in the parks at sunset and watched the lights come on knows the thrill of seeing that transformation. And Walt saw that at Electric Park.
So you have this 10,000 square foot building from 1922 and this desire to restore it. How do you see this revitalization building benefiting Kansas City?
Well, I think that that is a major reason why this is important, because Kansas City has not done much to recognize the important role it has in the history of Hollywood animation. I mean, an extremely important role in that history. So this will give us a chance to show Kansas City the important role that it played, and to show people who visit Kansas City the important role that Kansas City played in the evolution of Hollywood animation. It will, I mean, right now, over the past 20 years or so, when I've spent a lot of time at the Laugh-O-Gram building, it always surprises me how many people find their way there. And there's nothing to advertise it. There's not a sign. There's not anything to tell people where this building is. But people who really know and love Disney history find that building. By the way, it's at 31st and Forest Streets if you're in Kansas City. It's not hard to find if you know the address. But people come there today just to see the building, just to be near the place where these historic events took place. And if we just do a little bit of promotion, if people know there actually is something to see there, we think we'll get a very steady traffic of people who are visiting Kansas City for other reasons, or people who may come to Kansas City just to see the Disney history there. There is a large number of buildings which have Disney history connections. One of them is Union Station. Union Station is one of the most beautiful pieces of architecture in the Midwest. It is an awesome building, which the city and both on the Missouri side and the suburbs on the Kansas side combined many years ago to restore through a bi-state sales tax. That was historic in itself, to have two different states at the same time both vote to adopt a sales tax for the purpose of historic restoration. And they did indeed. They brought Union Station back from the brink of collapse to its original grandeur, and it is a grand building. So it's one of my favorite places to take people, especially Disney fans, is Union Station. When Walt lived at the Laugh-O-Gram building, he would go down to Union Station to take a shower once a week, whether he needed to or not. He would go down there and have a bath. And it was from Union Station that he left Kansas City for the final time. Got on the train with his cardboard suitcase, his mismatched suit, that one real Alice comedy in his suitcase, and went all the way on the Santa Fe to Hollywood, to Los Angeles, of course. And Union Station meant a great deal to Walt, who was always a train fan. Union Station was built while Walt lived in Kansas City. He had many connections, and I'm sure spent many hours at Union Station. But there are many other buildings that are still there. The Benton School, where he attended grade school, where he attended his first art classes, is still there. The Kansas City Art Institute, although it was not on its present campus, the Kansas City Art Institute was very important to Walt. And the Walt Disney Studio, when young people contact the studio and say, I want to work for the studio, often the studio would write back and say, well, here are some of the best schools in the country, and the Kansas City Art Institute has been on that list for many years. There are other locations. The home where Walt and his family lived for most of the 10 years they were in town, as I say, is on the National Register. It's not open to the public, but one can drive by. You can see the garage and back of that house that Walt and Elias built. And, there are just a lot of great locations in Kansas City that relate in one way or another to Walt Disney's days there. Like I say, there's just so many connections. Here's an odd one. In 1955, of course, when Disneyland opened, the TWA rocket ship was the centerpiece of Tomorrowland. And they had, an agreement, a contract with TWA, just as they did with many other corporate sponsors of the park in those days. Well, TWA at that time was owned by eccentric billionaire, and that's always how he's described, of course, eccentric billionaire Howard Hughes. And Howard, or somebody working for him, liked that rocket ship so much that they reproduced it in Kansas City. Now, the Kansas City version of the TWA Moonliner was smaller than the one in Disneyland, but it's still some 30 feet tall. And it was placed on top of TWA's new headquarters in Kansas City. Now, the airline is not headquartered there anymore, but it was in those days. They built a brand new, very innovative, modernistic building at 18th and Baltimore, just off Main Street. And on the corner of that building, they mounted a reproduction of the TWA Moonliner from Disneyland. And that rocket ship stood there for about 7 years until Douglas Aircraft took over the sponsorship of the Moonliner in Disneyland, and TWA decided to take that rocket down. Well, they sold it to a man who ran a company called Spacecraft, and Spacecraft made camper shells and fiberglass camping equipment. And so the owner of the Spacecraft RV and camper shell company moved his business down I-70, in fact, about midway between Columbia and Kansas City, to the little town of Concordia. And that Moonliner rocket stood there next to I-70 in Concordia for another 20 or 30 years. And then finally, when David Mumford and Bruce Gordon published their wonderful book about Disneyland called The Nickel Tour. Now, The Nickel Tour has been out of print for many years, but if you can find a copy, it's well worth it. It remains, I think, probably the single greatest history of Disneyland. And the title refers to the fact that postcards were great images of early Disneyland. So The Nickel Tour contains hundreds and hundreds of postcards of Disneyland. Well, in a footnote in The Nickel Tour, David and Bruce point out that there was a second Moonliner, and that it stands, in their first edition, they say it stands at a trailer park in Missouri. Well, it's not a trailer park, but I knew exactly what they meant. And I had seen that rocket for 20 or more years, 30 years probably at that time, and always thought it was pretty cool, but I did not recognize it to be a duplicate of the Moonliner, because, of course, it didn't have TWA on it. It didn't have anything to indicate what it was. But when I, and of course the Moonliner left Disneyland back in 1964, I think was the last year, maybe a little bit later than that. And so I'd never seen the original Moonliner. I'd only seen pictures of it. Well, I took some pictures of it over to Concordia, and when I went up to that rocket and compared it to those pictures, it was instantly obvious that that was exactly right. That Moonliner was a perfect reproduction of the Disneyland Moonliner. It had the same portholes, the same everything, just in a slightly smaller scale. And so including the cockpit, and this Moonliner actually had illumination that the Disneyland version did not. In other words, there was a light mounted behind each of the portholes and a light mounted in the cockpit. And so those lights hadn't been on for decades when I acquired this rocket ship. I was just lucky to be there at the right time. Mr. May was retiring. He was selling his business. And he says, yeah, I'll sell you that rocket ship. And we worked out a deal. And then I really didn't know what I was doing. But I got some friends, and we went over there, and we had an oxyacetylene torch and cut that rocket loose from its moorings, had a giant crane, and made a bed of giant tractor tires on a flatbed truck. And we hauled that thing down Interstate 70 to Columbia, and a good friend of mine named Don Jordan was the perfect guy to do the restoration. He did a hell of a good job and brought that thing back. It was rusty. It had wasp's nest and bird's nest, and the little baby bird's poop would wash down and had rusted streaks. There were holes in the side of the thing. It was galvanized steel. It was designed to be outdoors, but even it couldn't stand up to decades of neglect like that. So we brought it back, and today it looks exactly like it did originally, with the PWA logo and all of the original paint and every detail restored. It's now at the Airline History Museum in Kansas City. And what's, I think, even more ironic is that while we were doing that restoration, Disneyland, of course, and Bruce Gordon was the man responsible for it, did a renovation of Tomorrowland. And part of that renovation was to recreate the Disneyland Moonliner. And Bruce, I've talked with Bruce about this, and he wanted to put a full-scale one there. He couldn't sell that idea to the money guys, but they did fund one that's about 30 feet tall. So this rocket in Kansas City is almost exactly like the one that we do see today in Disneyland. And even stranger, I think, is the fact that while this was going on in Missouri, a developer named Brad Nichols, I believe is his name, or Nicholson, wanted to buy my rocket and put it back on the TWA building, because he had bought that old building, which had been vacant for many years, and was going to restore it, and he was getting historic tax credits from the state of Missouri. And that required him to restore the building to its original appearance, including having a rocket ship on top of it. And I said, well, you know, at first I thought about that because that's where the thing was designed to be. And then I thought, man, if we put it in the rain, it's going to rust. You don't restore an antique car and then park it out in the rain. So I said, no, Bruce, I'm not going to sell this to you, but you can photograph it, you can measure it, you can recreate it. And that's exactly what he did. And so today, Kansas City has two moonlighters. No other city has ever had two moonlighters, but Kansas City does. And mine, the original one from that building, is at the Airline History Museum up in what's called the Wheeler, downtown airport. And the reproduction of my rocket ship, and a very good reproduction, is on top of that building at 18th and Baltimore in downtown Kansas City.
So let's talk a little bit about the future of what Thank You Walt Disney hopes to do with that Laugh-O-Gram building. Tell us a little bit about those four public areas that you want to incorporate into that space.
Well, that's a concept. It may or may not be the final, you know, the final plan. But I think in general, we will probably follow that concept. We had help from some excellent architects at BNIM Architects in Kansas City. They were very generous. And, you know, so the concept is that we would have four general quadrants of that building. And one of them, of course, will be a recreation of Walt's studio, his offices. Luckily, we have not only moving picture film from that studio, but we also have lots of still photos of that studio as it appeared, and it won't be difficult to restore it to its exact original appearance. We will also have an area for both permanent and revolving exhibits. In other words, we have some great artifacts that we're going to display there, but we will also invite collectors who have a collection that, frankly, we think is worthy. And we invite them to display their collections here on a temporary and revolving basis. Of course, we want to give people a reason to come back, local folks, you know, a reason to come back to that studio. We'll also have an area that will be available for public events, maybe weddings, certainly for meetings and certainly for lectures and seminars on film history. And we're very likely to incorporate an educational facility which will give young animators, people who hope to become animators, a total historical overview of how animation began, how it was done in that very building, and how it's being done today. Digital animation, of course, is a very popular and rapidly growing field. University of Missouri, right here in Columbia, has one of the nation's foremost programs in digital animation. And so we're talking with University of Missouri about partnering with us on that undertaking. There's a group called Digistory KC, which has been very much a part of our planning and development. I'm president of that board as well as the Thank You Walt Disney board. And so that's our ambition. That's our hope, is that there will be ongoing educational activities, ongoing public activities. We hope that we'll be able to put in an old soda fountain, because there was indeed a Coca-Cola soda fountain in the drugstore on the corner of that building when Walt was there. And we want to tell people the story of Walt's life and work with, of course, a special focus and emphasis on his years in Kansas City.
As we wrap up here, I want to ask, how can people get involved? This is an exciting kind of adventure you are a part of, and I'm sure there are fans out there that would love to help in some sort of way. How can they help make that dream a reality?
Well, go to thankyouwaltdisney.org. That's our website, of course. That's a good portal to reach us. Anyone is welcome to email me directly. My email address, danviets@gmail.com. Happy to hear from people anytime. And you're absolutely right. It is exciting. It's always been exciting, and it's more exciting now. We really feel like we're on the verge of a major breakthrough. We hope we're going to have that building restored and open to the public within the next few years, and it will be quite a showpiece.
Dan Viets, thank you so much for coming on Dreamfinders.
You're welcome, Nathan. Thank you for the opportunity.
And that's it for this episode of Dreamfinders. It was so great to hear all the plans Dan and his group have for Laugh-O-Gram, so don't forget to check out thankyouwaltdisney.com and donate to their cause. You could help revitalize a part of Walt's forgotten past. Our podcast artwork is provided by J.P. Tanner. Find his other work at tanwoodcreative.com. This podcast is distributed by WDW News Today, the worldwide leader in Disney Parks news. Read all they have to offer at wdwnt.com. Dreamfinders is hosted and produced by yours truly, Nathan Hartman, who you can follow on Twitter at Some Stuff I Said. Also, tell your friends about the show, and please give us a rating and review on Apple Podcasts.
Also, if you or someone else you know would make a great guest on this program, feel free to email us at dreamfinders@wdwnt.com. I'm Nathan Hartman, and remember, if we can dream it, then we can do it. Dreamfinders is sponsored by Never Grow Up Vacations, the official travel partner of WDWNT.com. Never Grow Up Vacations specializes in trips to Disney destinations around the world. So be like us and never grow up. Head over to NeverGrowUpVacations.com to book your next trip today. Thank you.